Priscilla Ann Presley is an American actress and businesswoman. She is the former wife of American singer Elvis Presley, as well as co-founder and former chairwoman of Elvis Presley Enterprises, the company that turned Graceland into one of the top tourist attractions in the United States. In her acting career, Presley Co. starred with Leslie Nielsen in the Three Naked Gun films and played the role of Jenna Wade on the long-running television series Dallas. Life and career. 1935-1953, early years. Childhood in Tupelo. Teenage life in Memphis. 1953-1956, first recordings. Sam Phillips and Son Records. Early live performances and RCA Victor contract. I Louisiana Hayride / I, radio commercial, and first television performances. None. 1956-1958, commercial breakout and controversy. First national TV appearances and debut album. I Milton Berle Show / I and Hound Dog. None. I Steve Allen Show / I and first Sullivan appearance. None. Crazed Crowds and film debut. Lieber and Staller collaboration and draft notice. 1958-1960, military service and mother's death. On March 24, 1958, Presley was drafted into the United States Army at Fort Chaffee, Arkansas. His arrival was a major media event. Hundreds of people descended on Presley as he stepped from the bus. Photographers then accompanied him into the installation. Presley announced that he was looking forward to his military stint, saying that he did not want to be treated any differently from anyone else. The Army can do anything it wants with me. Between March 28 and September 17, 1958, Presley completed basic and advanced military training at Fort Hood, Texas, where he was temporarily assigned to Company A, 2D Medium Tank Battalion, 37th Armor. During the 2 weeks leave between his basic and advanced training in early June, Presley recorded 5 songs in Nashville. In early August, his mother was diagnosed with hepatitis, and her condition rapidly worsened. He was granted emergency leave to visit her and arrived in Memphis on August 12. 2 days later, she died of heart failure at the age of 46. Presley was devastated and never the same. Their relationship had remained extremely close even into his adulthood. They would use baby talk with each other and Presley would address her with pet names. On October 1, 1958, Presley was assigned to the 1st Medium Tank Battalion, 3 2D Armor, 3D Armored Division, at Ray Barracks, Germany, where he served as an armor intelligence specialist. On November 27, he was promoted to private first class and on June 1, 1959, to specialist fourth class. While on maneuvers, Presley was introduced to amphetamines by another soldier. He became practically evangelical about their benefits, not only for energy but for strength and weight loss as well, and many of his friends in the outfit joined him in indulging. The Army also introduced Presley to karate, which he studied seriously, training with Jürgen Seidel. It became a lifelong interest, which he later included in his live performances. Fellow soldiers have attested to Presley's wish to be seen as an able, ordinary soldier, despite his fame, and to his generosity. He donated his army pay to charity, purchased TV sets for the base, and bought an extra set of fatigues for everyone in his outfit. While in Bad Nauheim, Germany, Presley met 14-year-old Priscilla Bewley. They would eventually marry after a 7.5-year courtship. In her autobiography, Priscilla said that Presley was concerned that his 24-month spell as a GI would ruin his career. In special services, he would have been able to give musical performances and remain in touch with the public, but Parker had convinced him that to gain popular respect, he should serve his country as a regular soldier. Media reports echoed Presley's concerns about his career, but RCA Victor producer Steve Scholz and Freddie Beanstalk of Hill & Range had carefully prepared for his two-year hiatus. Armed with a substantial amount of unreleased material, they kept up a regular stream of successful releases. Between his induction and discharge, Presley had 10 top 40 hits, including Wear My Ring Around Your Neck, the best-selling Hard-Headed Woman, and One Night in 1958, and A Fool Such As I and the number one A Big Hunk of Love in 1959. RCA Victor also generated four albums compiling previously issued material during this period, most successfully Elvis Golden Records, which hit number 3 on the LP chart. Presley was promoted to sergeant on February 11, 1960. 1960-1968, focus on films. I Elvis is back / I. None. Lost in Hollywood. 1968-1973, comeback. I Elvis / I, the 68 comeback special. None. I From Elvis in Memphis / I and the International. None. Back on Tour and Meeting Nixon. Marriage Breakdown and I Aloha From Hawaii / I. None. 1973-1977, Health Deterioration and Death. Medical Crises and Last Studio Sessions. Final Months. Death. Cause of Death. While an autopsy, undertaken the same day Presley died, was still in progress, Memphis medical examiner Jerry Francisco announced that the immediate cause of death was cardiac arrest. Asked if drugs were involved, he declared that drugs played no role in Presley's death. In fact, drug use was heavily implicated in Presley's death, writes Gorelnik. The pathologists conducting the autopsy thought it possible, for instance, that he had suffered anaphylactic shock brought on by the codeine pills he had gotten from his dentist, to which he was known to have had a mild allergy. A pair of lab reports filed 2 months later strongly suggested that polypharmacy was the primary cause of death. One reported 14 drugs in Elvis' system, 10 in significant quantity. In 1979, forensic pathologist Cyril Wecht conducted a review of the reports and concluded that a combination of central nervous system depressants had resulted in Presley's accidental death. Forensic historian and pathologist Michael Bodden viewed the situation as complicated. Elvis had had an enlarged heart for a long time. That, together with his drug habit, caused his death. But he was difficult to diagnose, it was a judgment call. The competence and ethics of two of the centrally involved medical professionals were seriously questioned. Francisco had offered a cause of death before the autopsy was complete, claimed the underlying ailment was cardiac arrhythmia, a condition that can be determined only in someone who is still alive, and denied drugs played any part in Presley's death before the toxicology results were known. Allegations of a cover-up were widespread. While a 1981 trial of Presley's main physician, George C. Nichopoulos, exonerated him of criminal liability for his death, the facts were startling. In the first 8 months of 1977 alone, he had more than 10,000 doses of sedatives, amphetamines, and narcotics, all in Elvis' name. His license was suspended for 3 months. It was permanently revoked in the 1990s after the Tennessee Medical Board brought new charges of overprescription. In 1994, the Presley autopsy report was reopened. Joseph Davis, who had conducted thousands of autopsies as Miami-Dade County coroner, declared at its completion, "There is nothing in any of the data that supports a death from drugs. In fact, everything points to a sudden, violent heart attack." More recent research has revealed that Francisco did not speak for the entire pathology team. Other staff could say nothing with confidence until they got the results back from the laboratories, if then. That would be a matter of weeks. One of the examiners, E. Eric Muirhead, could not believe his ears. Francisco had not only presumed to speak for the hospital's team of pathologists, he had announced a conclusion that they had not reached. Early on, a meticulous dissection of the body confirmed Elvis was chronically ill with diabetes, glaucoma, and constipation. As they proceeded, the doctors saw evidence that his body had been racked over a span of years by a large and constant stream of drugs. They had also studied his hospital records, which included two admissions for drug detoxification and methadone treatments. Writer Frank Coffey thought Presley's death was due to a phenomenon called the Valsalva maneuver. In similar terms, Dan Warlick, who was present at the autopsy, believes Presley's chronic constipation the result of years of prescription drug abuse and high-fat, high-cholesterol gorging brought on what's known as Valsalva's maneuver. Put simply, the strain of attempting to defecate compressed the singer's abdominal aorta, shutting down his heart. However, in 2013, Forrest Tennant, who had testified as a defense witness in Nikopolos' trial, described his own analysis of Presley's available medical records. He concluded that Presley's drug abuse had led to falls, head trauma, and overdoses that damaged his brain, and that his death was due in part to a toxic reaction to codeine exacerbated by an undetected liver enzyme defect which can cause sudden cardiac arrhythmia. DNA analysis in 2014 of a hair sample, purported to be Presley's, found evidence of genetic variants that can lead to glaucoma, migraines, and obesity, a crucial variant associated with the heart muscle disease hypertrophic cardiomyopathy was also identified. Later developments. Between 1977 and 1981, six of Presley's posthumously released singles were top 10 country hits. Graceland was opened to the public in 1982. Attracting over 500,000 visitors annually, it became the second most visited home in the United States, after the White House. It was declared a National Historic Landmark in 2006. Presley has been inducted into 5 Music Halls of Fame, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the Country Music Hall of Fame, the Gospel Music Hall of Fame, the Rockabilly Hall of Fame, and the Memphis Music Hall of Fame. In 1984, he received the W.C. Handy Award from the Blues Foundation and the Academy of Country Music's first Golden Hat Award. In 1987, he received the American Music Awards Award of Merit. A Junkie XL remix of Presley's A Little Less Conversation was used in a Nike advertising campaign during the 2002 FIFA World Cup. It topped the charts in over 20 countries and was included in a compilation of Presley's number one hits, ELV1S, which was also an international success. The album returned Presley to the Billboard Summit for the first time in almost 3 decades. In 2003, a remix of Rubberneckin', a 1969 recording of Presley's, topped the U.S. sales chart, as did a 50th anniversary re-release of That's All Right the following year. The latter was an outright hit in Britain, debuting at number 3 on the pop chart. It also made the top 10 in Canada. In 2005, another 3 reissued singles, Jailhouse Rock, One Night / I Got Stung, and It's Now or Never, went to number 1 in the United Kingdom. They were part of a campaign that saw the re-release of all 18 of Presley's previous chart-topping UK singles. The first, All Shook Up, came with a collector's box that made it ineligible to chart again. Each of the other 17 reissues hit the British top 5. In 2005, Forbes named Presley the top-earning deceased celebrity for the 5th straight year, with a gross income of $45 million. He was placed second in 2006, returned to the top spot the next 2 years, and ranked 4th in 2009. The following year, he was ranked second, with his highest annual income ever $60 million spurred by the celebration of his 75th birthday and the launch of Cirque du Soleil's Viva Elvis show in Las Vegas. In November 2010, Viva Elvis, the album was released, setting his voice to newly recorded instrumental tracks. As of mid-2011, there were an estimated 15,000 licensed Presley products, and he was again the second highest earning deceased celebrity. 6 years later, he ranked fourth with earnings of $35 million, up $8 million from 2016, due in part to the opening of a new entertainment complex, Elvis Presley's Memphis, and hotel, the guest house at Graceland. In 2018, RCA/Legacy released Elvis Presley Where No One Stands Alone, a new album focused on Elvis's love of gospel music. Produced by Joel Weinshanker, Lisa Marie Presley and Andy Childs, the album introduced newly recorded instrumentation along with vocals from singers who had performed in the past with Elvis. It also included a reimagined duet with Lisa Marie, on the album's title track. In 2022, Baz Luhrmann's film Elvis, a musical biographical film about Presley's life, was released to theaters. Presley is portrayed by Austin Butler and Colonel Tom Parker by Tom Hanks. The film has grossed $261.8 million worldwide against its $85 million budget, becoming the second highest grossing music biopic of all time behind Bohemian Rhapsody and the fifth highest grossing Australian produced film. Artistry. Influences. Presley's earliest musical influence came from gospel. His mother recalled that from the age of two, at the Assembly of God Church in Tupelo attended by the family, he would slide down off my lap, run into the aisle and scramble up to the platform. There he would stand looking at the choir and trying to sing with them. In Memphis, Presley frequently attended all-night gospel singings at the Ellis Auditorium, where groups such as the Statesman Quartet led the music in a style that, Girlnik suggests, sowed the seeds of Presley's future stage act. The Statesmen were an electric combination, featuring some of the most thrillingly emotive singing and daringly unconventional showmanship in the entertainment world, dressed in suits that might have come out of the window of Lansky's. Bass singer Jim Weatherington, known universally as the Big Chief, maintained a steady bottom, ceaselessly jiggling first his left leg, then his right, with the material of the pants leg ballooning out and shimmering. He went about as far as you could go in gospel music, said Jake Hess. The women would jump up, just like they do for the pop shows. Preachers frequently objected to the lewd movements, but audiences reacted with screams and swoons. As a teenager, Presley's musical interests were wide-ranging, and he was deeply informed about both white and African-American musical idioms. Though he never had any formal training, he had a remarkable memory, and his musical knowledge was already considerable by the time he made his first professional recordings aged 19 in 1954. When Jerry Lieber and Mike Stoller met him 2 years later, they were astonished at his encyclopedic understanding of the blues, and, as Stoller put it, he certainly knew a lot more than we did about country music and gospel music. At a press conference the following year, he proudly declared, "I know practically every religious song that's ever been written." Musicianship. Presley played guitar, bass, and piano. He received his first guitar when he was 11 years old. While he couldn't read or write music and had no formal lessons, he was a natural musician and played everything by ear. Presley often played an instrument on his recordings and produced his own music. Presley played rhythm acoustic guitar on most of his Sun recordings and his 1950s RCA albums. He played electric bass guitar on Baby I Don't Care after his bassist Bill Black had trouble with the instrument. Presley played the bass line including the intro. Presley played piano on songs such as Old Shep and First in Line from his 1956 album Elvis. He is credited with playing piano on later albums such as From Elvis in Memphis and Moody Blue, and on Unchained Melody, which was one of the last songs that he recorded. Presley played lead guitar on one of his successful singles called Are You Lonesome Tonight? In the 68 comeback special, Elvis took over on lead electric guitar, the first time he had ever been seen with the instrument in public, playing it on songs such as Baby What You Want Me to Do and One Night. Presley played the back of his guitar on some of his hits such as All Shook Up, Don't Be Cruel, and Teddy Bear, providing percussion by slapping the instrument to create a beat. The album Elvis Is Back features Presley playing a lot of acoustic guitar on songs such as I Will Be Home Again and Like a Baby. Musical styles and genres. Presley was a central figure in the development of rockabilly, according to music historians. Rockabilly crystallized into a recognizable style in 1954 with Elvis Presley's first release, on the Sun label, writes Craig Morrison. Paul Friedlander describes the defining elements of rockabilly, which he similarly characterizes as essentially an Elvis Presley construction, the raw, emotive, and slurred vocal style and emphasis on rhythmic feeling, the blues with the string band and strummed rhythm guitar country. In That's All Right, the Presley Trio's first record, Scotty Moore's guitar solo, a combination of Merle Travis-style country finger-picking, double-stop slides from acoustic boogie, and blues-based bent note, single-string work, is a microcosm of this fusion. While Catherine Charlton likewise calls Presley rockabilly's originator, Carl Perkins has explicitly stated that Phillips, Elvis, and I didn't create rockabilly and, according to Michael Campbell, Bill Haley recorded the first big rockabilly hit. In Moore's view, too, it had been there for quite a while, really. Carl Perkins was doing basically the same sort of thing up around Jackson, and I know for a fact Jerry Lee Lewis had been playing that kind of music ever since he was 10 years old. At RCA Victor, Presley's rock and roll sound grew distinct from rockabilly with group chorus vocals, more heavily amplified electric guitars and a tougher, more intense manner. While he was known for taking songs from various sources and giving them a rockabilly/rock-and-roll treatment, he also recorded songs in other genres from early in his career, from the pop standard Blue Moon at Sun Records to the country ballad How's the World Treating You, on his second RCA Victor LP to the blues of Santa Claus Is Back in Town. In 1957, his first gospel record was released, the four-song EP Peace in the Valley. Certified as a million-seller, it became the top-selling gospel EP in recording history. Presley would record gospel periodically for the rest of his life. After his return from military service in 1960, Presley continued to perform rock and roll, but the characteristic style was substantially toned down. His first post-Army single, the number one hit Stuck on You, is typical of this shift. RCA Victor Publicity referred to its mild rock beat, discographer Ernst Jorgensen calls it upbeat pop. The number five She's Not You integrates the Jordanaires so completely, it's practically doo-wop. The modern blues/R&B sound captured with success on Elvis Is Back was essentially abandoned for 6 years until such 1966-67 recordings as Down in the Alley and High Heel Sneakers. Presley's output during most of the 1960s emphasized pop music, often in the form of ballads such as Are You Lonesome Tonight, a number one in 1960. It's Now or Never, which also topped the chart that year, was a classically influenced variation of pop based on the Neapolitan song O Sole Mio and concluding with a full-voiced operatic cadence. These were both dramatic numbers, but most of what Presley recorded for his many film soundtracks was in a much lighter vein. While Presley performed several of his classic ballads for the 68 comeback special, the sound of the show was dominated by aggressive rock and roll. He recorded few new straight rock and roll songs thereafter, as he explained, they had become hard to find. A significant exception was Burning Love, his last major hit on the pop charts. Like his work of the 1950s, Presley's subsequent recordings reworked pop and country songs, but in markedly different permutations. His stylistic range now began to embrace a more contemporary rock sound as well as soul and funk. Much of Elvis in Memphis, as well as Suspicious Minds, cut at the same sessions, reflected this new rock and soul fusion. In the mid-1970s, many of his singles found a home on country radio, the field where he first became a star. Vocal style and range. The developmental arc of Presley's singing voice, as described by critic Dave Marsh, goes from high and thrilled in the early days, lower and perplexed in the final months. Marsh credits Presley with the introduction of the vocal stutter on 1955's Baby Let's Play House. When on Don't Be Cruel, Presley slides into AM that marks the transition between the first two verses. He shows how masterful his relaxed style really is. Marsh describes the vocal performance on Can't Help Falling in Love as one of gentle insistence and delicacy of phrasing, with the line Shall I Stay pronounced as if the words are fragile as crystal. Jorgensen calls the 1966 recording of How Great Thou Art an extraordinary fulfillment of his vocal ambitions, as Presley crafted for himself an ad hoc arrangement in which he took every part of the four-part vocal, from bass intro to the soaring heights of the song's operatic climax, becoming a kind of one-man quartet. Girl Nick finds Stand By Me from the same gospel sessions a beautifully articulated, almost nakedly yearning performance, but, by contrast, feels that Presley reaches beyond his powers on Where No One Stands Alone, resorting to a kind of inelegant bellowing to push out a sound that Jake Hess of the Statesman Quartet had in his command. Hess himself thought that while others might have voices the equal of Presley's, he had that certain something that everyone searches for all during their lifetime. Girl Nick attempts to pinpoint that something, the warmth of his voice, his controlled use of both vibrato technique and natural falsetto range, the subtlety and deeply felt conviction of his singing were all qualities recognizably belonging to his talent but just as recognizably not to be achieved without sustained dedication and effort. Marsh praises his 1968 reading of U.S. Mail, bearing down on the hard guy lyrics, not sending them up or overplaying them but tossing them around with that astonishingly tough yet gentle assurance that he brought to his Sun Records. The performance on In the Ghetto is, according to Jorgensen, devoid of any of his characteristic vocal tricks or mannerisms, instead relying on the exceptional clarity and sensitivity of his voice. Girl Nick describes the song's delivery as of almost translucent eloquence, so quietly confident in its simplicity. On Suspicious Minds, Girl Nick hears essentially the same remarkable mixture of tenderness and poise, but supplemented with an expressive quality somewhere between stoicism and anguish. Music critic Henry Pleasance observes that Presley has been described variously as a baritone and a tenor. An extraordinary compass, and a very wide range of vocal color have something to do with this divergence of opinion. He identifies Presley as a high baritone, calculating his range as 2 octaves and 1/3, from the baritone low G to the tenor high B, with an upward extension in falsetto to at least a D-flat. Presley's best octave is in the middle, D-flat to D-flat, granting an extra full step up or down. In Pleasant's view, his voice was variable and unpredictable at the bottom, often brilliant at the top, with the capacity for full-voiced high GS and as that an opera baritone might envy. Scholar Lindsay Waters, who figures Presley's range as 2 1/4 octaves, emphasizes that his voice had an emotional range from tender whispers to sighs down to shouts, grunts, grumbles, and sheer gruffness that could move the listener from calmness and surrender, to fear. His voice cannot be measured in octaves, but in decibels. Even that misses the problem of how to measure delicate whispers that are hardly audible at all. Presley was always able to duplicate the open, hoarse, ecstatic, screaming, shouting, wailing, reckless sound of the black rhythm and blues and gospel singers, writes Pleasance, and also demonstrated a remarkable ability to assimilate many other vocal styles. Public image. Relationship with the African American community. When Dewey Phillips first aired That's All Right on Memphis WHBQ, many listeners who contacted the station by phone and telegram to ask for it again assumed that its singer was black. From the beginning of his national fame, Presley expressed respect for African American performers and their music, and disregard for the norms of segregation and racial prejudice then prevalent in the South. Interviewed in 1956, he recalled how in his childhood he would listen to blues musician Arthur Crudup, the originator of That's All Right, bang his box the way I do now, and I said if I ever got to the place where I could feel all old Arthur felt, I'd be a music man like nobody ever saw. The Memphis World, an African-American newspaper, reported that Presley, the rock and roll phenomenon, cracked Memphis segregation laws by attending the local amusement park on what was designated as its colored night. Such statements and actions led Presley to be generally hailed in the black community during the early days of his stardom. In contrast, many white adults did not like him, and condemned him as depraved. Anti-Negro prejudice doubtless figured in adult antagonism. Regardless of whether parents were aware of the Negro sexual origins of the phrase rock and roll, Presley impressed them as the visual and oral embodiment of sex. Despite the largely positive view of Presley held by African Americans, a rumor spread in mid-1957 that he had at some point announced, "The only thing Negroes can do for me is buy my records and shine my shoes." A journalist with the National African American Weekly Jet, Louis Robinson, pursued the story. On the set of Jailhouse Rock, Presley granted Robinson an interview, though he was no longer dealing with the mainstream press. He denied making such a statement, "I never said anything like that, and people who know me know that I wouldn't have said it. A lot of people seem to think I started this business. But rock and roll was here a long time before I came along. Nobody can sing that kind of music like colored people. Let's face it, I can't sing like Fats Domino can. I know that." Robinson found no evidence that the remark had ever been made, and on the contrary elicited testimony from many individuals indicating that Presley was anything but racist. Blues singer Ivory Joe Hunter, who had heard the rumor before he visited Graceland one evening, reported of Presley, "He showed me every courtesy, and I think he's one of the greatest." Though the rumored remark was discredited, it was still being used against Presley decades later. The identification of Presley with racism, either personally or symbolically, was expressed in the lyrics of the 1989 rap hit Fight the Power, by Public Enemy. "Elvis was a hero to most / but he never meant shit to me / straight up racist that sucker was / simple and plain / motherfuck him and John Wayne." The persistence of such attitudes was fueled by resentment over the fact that Presley, whose musical and visual performance idiom owed much to African American sources, achieved the cultural acknowledgement and commercial success largely denied his black peers. Into the 21st century, the notion that Presley had stolen black music still found adherents. Notable among African American entertainers expressly rejecting this view was Jackie Wilson, who argued, "A lot of people have accused Elvis of stealing the black man's music, when in fact, almost every black solo entertainer copied his stage mannerisms from Elvis." Moreover, Presley also acknowledged his debt to African American musicians throughout his career. Addressing his 68 comeback special audience, he said, "Rock and roll music is basically gospel or rhythm and blues, or it sprang from that. People have been adding to it, adding instruments to it, experimenting with it, but it all boils down to." 9 years earlier, he had said, "Rock and roll has been around for many years. It used to be called rhythm and blues. Sex symbol." Presley's physical attractiveness and sexual appeal were widely acknowledged. He was once beautiful, astonishingly beautiful, according to critic Mark Feeney. Television director Steve Binder, no fan of Presley's music before he oversaw the 1968 comeback special, reported, "I'm straight as an arrow and I got to tell you, you stop, whether you're male or female, to look at him. He was that good-looking. And if you never knew he was a superstar, it wouldn't make any difference. If he'd walked in the room, you'd know somebody special was in your presence. His performance style, as much as his physical beauty, was responsible for Presley's eroticized image. Writing in 1970, critic George Melly described him as the master of the sexual simile, treating his guitar as both phallus and girl. In his Presley obituary, Lester Bangs credited him as the man who brought overt blatant vulgar sexual frenzy to the popular arts in America. Ed Sullivan's declaration that he perceived a soda bottle in Presley's trousers was echoed by rumors involving a similarly positioned toilet roll tube or lead bar. While Presley was marketed as an icon of heterosexuality, some cultural critics have argued that his image was ambiguous. In 1959, Sight and Sound's Peter John Dyer described his on-screen persona as aggressively bisexual in appeal. Brett Farmer places the orgasmic gyrations of the title dance sequence in Jailhouse Rock within a lineage of cinematic musical numbers that offer a spectacular eroticization, if not homoeroticization, of the male image. In the analysis of Yvonne Tasker, Elvis was an ambivalent figure who articulated a peculiar feministe, objectifying version of white working-class masculinity as aggressive sexual display. Reinforcing Presley's image as a sex symbol were the reports of his dalliances with various Hollywood stars and starlets, from Natalie Wood in the 1950s to Connie Stevens and Anne Margaret in the 1960s to Candice Bergen and Cybill Shepherd in the 1970s. June Wanico of Memphis, one of Presley's early girlfriends, later blamed Parker for encouraging him to choose his dating partners with publicity in mind. Presley never grew comfortable with the Hollywood scene, and most of these relationships were insubstantial. Equestrian. Elvis kept several horses at Graceland, and horses remain important to the Graceland estate. A local former teacher, Aileen Alexander, has taken care of the horses at Graceland for 38 years. She and Priscilla Presley have a love for horses and have formed a special friendship. It was because of Priscilla that Elvis brought horses to Graceland. "He got me my first horse as a Christmas present, Domino," said Priscilla Presley. Alexander now serves as Graceland's ambassador. She is one of three of the original staff members still working at the estate. The horse named Palomino Rising Sun was Elvis' favorite horse, and there are many photographs of him riding him. Associates. Colonel Parker and the Aberbacks. Once he became Presley's manager, Colonel Tom Parker insisted on exceptionally tight control over his client's career. Early on, he and his hill and range allies, the brothers Gene and Julian Aberbach, perceived the close relationship that developed between Presley and songwriters Jerry Lieber and Mike Stoller as a serious threat to that control. Parker effectively ended the relationship, deliberately or not, with the new contract he sent Lieber in early 1958. Lieber thought there was a mistake. The sheet of paper was blank except for Parker's signature and a line on which to enter his. "There's no mistake, boy, just sign it and return it," Parker directed. "Don't worry, we'll fill it in later." Lieber declined, and Presley's fruitful collaboration with the writing team was over. Other respected songwriters lost interest in or simply avoided writing for Presley because of the requirement that they surrender a third of their usual royalties. By 1967, Parker's contracts gave him 50% of most of Presley's earnings from recordings, films, and merchandise. Beginning in February 1972, he took a third of the profit from live appearances. A January 1976 agreement entitled him to half of that as well. Priscilla Presley noted that Elvis detested the business side of his career. He would sign a contract without even reading it. Presley's friend Marty Lacker regarded Parker as a hustler and a con artist. He was only interested in now money, get the buck and get gone. Priscilla Presley said after Parker's death, however, that Elvis was happy to pay 50% to Parker to manage him. Lacker was instrumental in convincing Presley to record with Memphis producer Chips Moman and his hand-picked musicians at American Sound Studio in early 1969. The American Sound sessions represented a significant departure from the control customarily exerted by Hill and Range. Moman still had to deal with the publisher's staff on site, whose song suggestions he regarded as unacceptable. He was on the verge of quitting until Presley ordered the Hill and Range personnel out of the studio. Although RCA executive Joan Deary was later full of praise for the producer's song choices and the quality of the recordings, Moman, to his fury, received neither credit on the records nor royalties for his work. Throughout his entire career, Presley performed in only three venues outside the United States, all of them in Canada, during brief tours there in 1957. In 1968, he remarked, "Before too long I'm going to make some personal appearance tours. I'll probably start out here in this country and after that, play some concerts abroad, probably starting in Europe. I want to see some places I've never seen before." Rumors that he would play overseas for the first time were fueled in 1974 by a $1 million bid for an Australian tour. Parker was uncharacteristically reluctant, prompting those close to Presley to speculate about the manager's past and the reasons for his evident unwillingness to apply for a passport. After Presley's death, it was revealed that Parker was born Andreas Cornelis van Kuijk in the Netherlands, having immigrated illegally to the U.S. He had reason to fear that if he left the country, he would not be allowed back in again. Parker ultimately squelched any notions Presley had of working abroad, claiming that foreign security was poor and the venues unsuitable for a star of his magnitude. Parker arguably exercised tightest control over Presley's film career. Hal Wallace said, "I'd rather try and close a deal with the devil than with Parker." Fellow film producer Sam Katzman described him as the biggest con artist in the world. In 1957, Robert Mitchum asked Presley to co-star with him in Thunder Road, which Mitchum was producing and writing. According to George Klein, one of his oldest friends, Presley was also offered starring roles in West Side Story and Midnight Cowboy. In 1974, Barbara Streisand approached Presley to star with her in the remake of A Star Is Born. In each case, any ambitions Presley may have had to play such parts were thwarted by his manager's negotiating demands or flat refusals. In Lacker's description, the only thing that kept Elvis going after the early years was a new challenge. But Parker kept running everything into the ground. The prevailing attitude may have been summed up best by the response Lieber and Stoller received when they brought a serious film project for Presley to Parker and the Hill and Range owners for their consideration. In Lieber's telling, Gene Averbach warned them to never again try to interfere with the business or artistic workings of the process known as Elvis Presley. Memphis Mafia. In the early 1960s, the circle of friends with whom Presley constantly surrounded himself until his death came to be known as the Memphis Mafia. Surrounded by the parasitic presence, as journalist John Harris puts it, it was no wonder that as he slid into addiction and torpor, no one raised the alarm. To them, Elvis was the bank, and it had to remain open. Tony Brown, who played piano for Presley regularly in the last 2 years of Presley's life, observed his rapidly declining health and the urgent need to address it, but we all knew it was hopeless because Elvis was surrounded by that little circle of people, all those so-called friends. In the Memphis Mafia's defense, Marty Lacker has said, was his own man. If we hadn't been around, he would have been dead a lot earlier. Larry Geller became Presley's hairdresser in 1964. Unlike others in the Memphis Mafia, he was interested in spiritual questions and recalls how, from their first conversation, Presley revealed his secret thoughts and anxieties. "I mean, there has to be a purpose. There's got to be a reason why I was chosen to be Elvis Presley. I swear to God, no one knows how lonely I get. and how empty I really feel. Thereafter, Geller supplied him with books on religion and mysticism, which Presley read voraciously. Presley would be preoccupied by such matters for much of his life, taking trunkloads of books on tour. Legacy. Presley's rise to national attention in 1956 transformed the field of popular music and had a huge effect on the broader scope of popular culture. As the catalyst for the cultural revolution that was rock and roll, he was central not only to defining it as a musical genre but in making it a touchstone of youth culture and rebellious attitude. With its racially mixed origins repeatedly affirmed by Presley, rock and roll's occupation of a central position in mainstream American culture facilitated a new acceptance and appreciation of black culture. In this regard, Little Richard said of Presley, he was an integrator. Elvis was a blessing. They wouldn't let black music through. He opened the door for black music. Al Green agreed, he broke the ice for all of us. President Jimmy Carter remarked on his legacy in 1977, his music and his personality, fusing the styles of white country and black rhythm and blues, permanently changed the face of American popular culture. His following was immense, and he was a symbol to people the world over of the vitality, rebelliousness, and good humor of his country. Presley also heralded the vastly expanded reach of celebrity in the era of mass communication. At the age of 21, within a year of his first appearance on American network television, he was regarded as one of the most famous people in the world. Presley's name, image, and voice are recognized around the globe. He has inspired a legion of impersonators. In polls and surveys, he is recognized as one of the most important popular music artists and influential Americans. American composer and conductor Leonard Bernstein said, "Elvis Presley is the greatest cultural force in the 20th century. He introduced the beat to everything and he changed everything: music, language, clothes. It's a whole new social revolution. The 60s came from it." John Lennon said that nothing really affected me until Elvis. Bob Dylan described the sensation of first hearing Presley as like busting out of jail. For much of his adult life, Presley, with his rise from poverty to riches and massive fame, had seemed to epitomize the American dream. In his final years and even more so after his death, and the revelations about its circumstances, he became a symbol of excess and gluttony. Increasing attention, for instance, was paid to his appetite for the rich, heavy Southern cooking of his upbringing. Foods such as chicken fried steak and biscuits and gravy. In particular, his love of calorie-laden fried peanut butter, banana, and bacon sandwiches, now known as Elvis sandwiches, came to stand for this aspect of his persona. But the Elvis sandwich represents more than just unhealthy overindulgence, as media and culture scholar Robert Thompson describes. The unsophisticated treat also signifies Presley's enduring all-American appeal. He wasn't only the king, he was one of us. Since 1977, there have been numerous alleged sightings of Presley. A long-standing conspiracy theory among some fans is that he faked his death. Adherents cite alleged discrepancies in the death certificate, reports of a wax dummy in his original coffin, and accounts of Presley planning a diversion so he could retire in peace. An unusually large number of fans have domestic shrines devoted to Presley and journey to sites with which he is connected, however faintly. Every August 16, the anniversary of his death, thousands of people gather outside Graceland and celebrate his memory with a candlelight ritual. With Elvis, it is not just his music that has survived death, writes Ted Harrison. He himself has been raised, like a medieval saint, to a figure of cultic status. It is as if he has been canonized by acclamation. On the 25th anniversary of Presley's death, the New York Times asserted, "All the talentless impersonators and appalling black velvet paintings on display can make him seem little more than a perverse and distant memory." But before Elvis was camp, he was its opposite, a genuine cultural force. Elvis' breakthroughs are underappreciated because in this rock and roll age, his hard-rocking music and sultry style have triumphed so completely. Not only Presley's achievements but his failings as well, are seen by some cultural observers as adding to the power of his legacy, as in this description by Greil Marcus. Elvis Presley is a supreme figure in American life, one whose presence, no matter how banal or predictable, brooks no real comparisons. The cultural range of his music has expanded to the point where it includes not only the hits of the day, but also patriotic recitals, pure country gospel, and really dirty blues. Elvis has emerged as a great artist, a great rocker, a great purveyor of schlock, a great heartthrob, a great bore, a great symbol of potency, a great ham, a great nice person, and, yes, a great American. Achievements. Presley remains the best-selling solo music artist according to Guinness World Records, with sales estimated by various sources up to 500 million 1 billion. Presley holds the records for most songs charting in Billboard's Top 40 and Top 100, according to chart statistician Joel Whitman, 139 according to Presley historian Adam Victor. Presley's rankings for top 10 and number 1 hits vary depending on how the double-sided Hound Dog / Don't Be Cruel and Don't / I Beg of You singles, which precede the inception of Billboard's Unified Hot 100 chart, are analyzed. According to Whitman's analysis, Presley holds the record with 38, tying with Madonna. Per Billboard's current assessment, he ranks second with 36. Whitman and Billboard concur that the Beatles hold the record for most number one hits with 20, and that Mariah Carey is second with 18. Whitman has Presley also with 18, and thus tied for second. Billboard has him third with 17. Presley retains the record for cumulative weeks at number one, alone at 80, according to Whitman and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, tied with Carey at 79, according to Billboard. He holds the records for most number one singles on the UK chart with 21 and singles reaching the top 10 with 76. As an album artist, Presley is credited by Billboard with the record for the most albums charting in the Billboard 200, 129, far ahead of second place Frank Sinatra's 82. He also holds the record for most time spent at number one on the Billboard 200, 67 weeks. In 2015 and 2016, two albums setting Presley's vocals against music by the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, If I Can Dream and The Wonder of You, both reached number one in the United Kingdom. This gave him a new record for number one UK albums by a solo artist with 13, and extended his record for longest span between number one albums by anybody. Presley had first topped the British chart in 1956 with his self-titled debut. As of 2020, the Recording Industry Association of America credits Presley with 146.5 million certified album sales in the US, third all-time behind the Beatles and Garth Brooks. He holds the records for most gold albums, and most platinum albums. His 25 multi-platinum albums is second behind the Beatles' 26. His total of 197 album certification awards far outpaces the Beatles' second best 122. He has the third most gold singles, and the eighth most platinum singles. In 2012, the spider Peridoni Presleyi was named in his honor. In 2018, President Donald Trump awarded Presley the Presidential Medal of Freedom posthumously. Bands. Presley worked with many bands and studio musicians over the course of his career. The following is a list and timeline of the most prominent musicians that worked with Presley during his lifetime. Discography. A vast number of recordings have been issued under Presley's name. The total number of his original master recordings has been variously calculated as 665 and 711. His career began and he was most successful during an era when singles were the primary commercial medium for pop music. In the case of his albums, the distinction between official studio records and other forms is often blurred. For most of the 1960s, his recording career focused on soundtrack albums. In the 1970s, his most heavily promoted and best-selling LP releases tended to be concert albums. Filmography. Films starred. TV concert specials. Elvis. Aloha from Hawaii via satellite. Elvis in concert. See also. Explanatory notes.